Praise the Lord. All right. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Come on. You can do better than that. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Praise the Lord. Again, we are so thankful to the Lord for the way He is progressing our preparations for this Sunday. It's a major evangelistic event. And please, really pray, and especially for those that you've invited. You still have a week to invite them, to remind them to join us. And if you have invited someone, please take care of them. Make sure that you usher them in. Try to seat them where you are seated so that you can be close to them, so that you can at least minister to them. And when the time comes for the altar call, you can assist them. You can ask them to come with you, or you can just join them if they're a little embarrassed, you know. So please take care of your guests. This Sunday, of course, we have our ushers and usherettes who will be there at the entrance, but we want to make sure that they feel at home, and the best way to do that are those who invited them to make them feel at home. All right, so praise the Lord. Again, we're continuing with our series with entitled Fresh Lessons from Former Leaders. We're doing a biographical sketch. The different men and women who have been mightily used by God. And 2 Sundays ago, we looked at the life of Nehemiah, and we looked at the essentials on finishing a task. And we learned at least 3 things. To finish a task, you need to fortify your faith, you need to fix your focus, and you need to face your foes. Those 3 things we learned from the life of Nehemiah. And then last Sunday, the shortest biography in the whole of the Bible. This is with regards to the life of Jabez. The prayer of Jabez. We looked at his predicament. His particular name means pain. We looked at his petition. And then we looked at the way the Lord answered his prayer and granted him his request, his prosperity. And this guy, you know, what really changed his life is his faith in God and really his audacious a request from God that his name will not be true to himself, that he will not be a source of pain. So he asked and pleaded for God's provision. He pleaded for God's presence, and then he pleaded for God's protection. And these 2 verses, very short biography of this man, ended with these words: so God granted him what he requested. Wow, praise the Lord. And that's the life of Jabez. Well, this afternoon, we're going to look at the life of Joseph. At least 1 episode in the life of Joseph. You know, we can look into his life. We can spend the whole month studying his life. But this incredible man who withstood years of unfair treatment. Brothers and sisters, if I ask you this afternoon, how do you respond when things are not going your way? How do you respond? Like, what do you do when everything goes wrong? You know, you have 2 flat tires in a day. Wow, that's a real bad day. Have you had a really, really bad day? Or have you had a day when nothing seemed to go right? And friends, if you think you had a bad day, consider the story of this man who attempted to explain his accident to the insurance company. I actually printed this in our bulletin. At least the shorter version is there. So this is, and you think you had a bad day. Listen to his story. If this is a real bad day. I'm writing response to your request for additional information. In block number 3 of the accident reporting form, I put poor planning as the cause of my accident. You said in your letter that I should explain more, and I trust that the following details are sufficient. I'm a bricklayer by trade. On the day of the accident, I was working alone on the roof of a new 6-story building. When I completed my work, I discovered that I had about 500 pounds of bricks left over. Rather than carry the bricks down by hand, I decided to lower them in a barrel by using a pulley, which fortunately was attached to the side of the building at the 6th floor. Securing the rope at the ground level, I went up to the roof, swung the barrel out, and loaded the bricks into it. Then I went back to the ground. ground, and tightrope, holding it tightly to ensure a slow descent of the 500 pounds of bricks. You will note in block number 11 of the accident reporting form that I weigh 175 pounds. So it's 175 pounds down here and 500 pounds coming down from the sixth floor. Due to my surprise of being jerked off the ground so suddenly, I lost my presence of mind and forgot to let go of the rope. Needless to say, I proceeded at a rather rapid rate up the side of the building. In the vicinity of the third floor, I met the barrel coming down. This explains the fractured skull and broken collarbone. Slowed only slightly, I continued my rapid ascent, not stopping until the fingers of my right hand were two knuckles deep into the pulley. Fortunately, by this time, I had regained my presence of mind and was able to hold tightly to the rope in spite of the pain. At approximately the same time, however, the barrel of bricks hit the ground and the bottom fell out of the barrel. Devoid of the weight of the bricks, the barrel now weighed approximately 50 pounds. I refer you again to my weight in block number 11. As you might imagine, I began to rapid descent down the side of the building. In the vicinity of the third floor, I met the barrel coming up. This accounts for the two fractured ankles and lacerations of my legs and lower body. The encounter with the barrel slowed me enough to lessen my injuries when I fell into the pile of bricks, and fortunately, only three vertebrae were cracked. I am sorry to report, however, that as I lay there on the bricks of pain, in pain, unable to move, and watching the barrel six stories above, I again lost my presence of mind. I let go of the rope. Wow! If you think you had a bad day, now this guy really had a very, very bad day. But you know what, friends, when we talk about the life of Joseph, we're not talking only about a bad day, not even a bad week, not even a bad month. We're talking about several years, bad years. And Joseph, in the midst of difficult situations, he did not let go of the rope. And so I've entitled this sermon this afternoon about Joseph. I've entitled it, What to Do When Life Doesn't Seem to Make Sense. We're looking at Genesis chapter 39. If you have your Bibles with you, you can go to Genesis 39. What to Do When Life Doesn't Seem to Make Sense. I'd like for us to read a few verses from chapter 39, verses 6 to 12 and then 19 to 20. Let's all stand, please, as we read God's Word together. Genesis chapter 39, 6 to 12, and then jump to 19 and 20. Ready? Ready? Read. So Potiphar left everything he had in Joseph's care. With Joseph in charge, he did not concern himself with anything except the food he ate. Now Joseph was well-built and handsome. And after a while, his master's wife took notice of Joseph and said, Come to bed with me. But he refused. With me in charge, he told her, My master does not concern himself with anything in the house. Everything he owes, he has entrusted to my care. No one is greater in this house than I am. My master has withheld nothing from me except you, because you are his wife. How then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God? And though she spoke to Joseph day after day, he refused to go to bed with her or even be with her. One day he went into the house to attend to his duties, and none of the household servants was inside. Was inside right there. She caught him by his cloak and said, Come to bed with me. But he left his cloak in her hand and ran out of the house. When his master heard the story, his wife told him, saying, This is how your slave treated me. He burned with anger. Joseph's master took him and put him in prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. Let's pray. Almighty God, Lord, we just ask that you'd help each one of us discern what your spirit is saying to us today. Lord, we pray that our minds will be free from any concern right now. Cover us with your precious blood. And Lord, we pray that this study about the life of Joseph will come alive and will make a dent in the way we live today. And so we commit ourselves to you right now and ask for your Holy Spirit to minister to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may take your seats. Now I want you to understand carefully the title that we have here. I didn't say what to do when life doesn't make sense. I want to underscore the word seem. What to do when life doesn't seem to make sense. Because brothers and sisters, just because life doesn't make sense to you, it doesn't mean it doesn't make sense. And so the question is, what do you do when life doesn't seem to make sense? You know, we always heard of some cliches, you know, the world will try to tell us when we're going through some tough times, and sometimes they seem good advice. For example, here's one, people will tell us, cheer up, it could be worse. You know, that's a lot of comfort, isn't it? Cheer up, it could be worse. One fellow said, yeah, I cheered up and it got worse. Another of those cliches that we hear when we go through tough times, the world would say to us, when you get to the end of your rope, tie a knot and hang on. Now that will really bless your heart, isn't it? I mean, if you get to the end of your rope, tie a knot and hang on. Have you seen a guy, you know, dangling over a cliff trying to tie a knot? Friends, that will be very tough. And so that's not a real good advice for somebody who is hurting. But the Lord would tell us these things because it doesn't really understand what's going on. But this chapter in the book of Genesis, chapter 39, is going to tell us some things that we can do. Some principles that you and I can apply when life doesn't seem to make sense. Brothers and sisters, I don't have to be a prophet to tell you right now that one of these days, you will be in darkness. One of these days will be a difficult day. One of these days you will even be facing death. Why? Well, we all live in a dying world. According to the Apostle Paul, the whole creation is groaning, and it's because of sin. Now, our spirits may have been saved and we are growing from one degree of glory to another, but friends, you can be sure that our bodies are deteriorating away. Even right now, where you're seated, your cells are dying. Can you feel them dying right now? Just where you are right now, where you're seated. You know, all of us, the time is clicking and we're dying. And that's why we all look forward to that rapture, the day when we will be changed in the twinkling of an eye, and you and I will receive our resurrection body, never to die anymore, and then during the millennium, live in a perfect world. But brothers and sisters, right now, right here, in planet Earth, while we try to live a holy life in this unholy world, life will be difficult. And I pray that the life of Joseph would reveal to us at least 5 things of what we can do when life doesn't seem to make sense. Now I'm just borrowing an outline here. This is not my original outline. And so this is just from one of my favorite preachers. But let me give you a little background to this passage. Here in Genesis chapter 39, we find Joseph in Egypt at the age of 17, sold by his brothers as a slave. He was carried down by a caravan into Egypt, and then he was bought by a man named Potiphar. He had been ripped from his home and his friends. He was dragged across the desert to a land that he had never known, surrounded by strange people, talking in a language he had never heard. At 17, he lost everything. Everything that he loved, everything that is important to him. He now lives a life at the whim of his master. He is the lowest form of life in the nation of Egypt. He has nothing. He owns nothing. He is nothing. All other slaves in Egypt, they have no rights. They have no status. They have no value. And friends, just when you think it could not get worse, he was falsely accused of attempted rape and then thrown into prison to be remembered no more. Now, the whole time this was happening, Joseph really done anything wrong. He has not done anything wrong. As a matter of fact, friends, he's been doing everything right. The only asset that he had, which became a liability to him, is his physical description. And it says there, his physical description, he was well-built and handsome. Wow! Now that's a deadly combination. He was well-built and handsome. Now girls, that's what you call a hunk. Now I tried to look for a picture in the internet of a hunk. You know, I found this guy who was well-built and handsome. I mean, you can actually see his muscles bulging out. He is well-built and he's handsome. That's a selfie, you know? Well-built and handsome. So you can call me Pastor Hunk. Now, Joseph, even though he's a hunk, he dared to be different and he purposed to be pure. And so Mrs. Potiphar tried to seduce him day and night, but Joseph avoided the temptation and wouldn't even stay in a room if he's going to be alone with her. Now, how's that for a change? That means, friends, he made sure that there won't be any compromising situation that he'll be in. He avoided to beso-beso. He avoided unnecessary touches. So there won't be no hint of sexual immorality. I think it was Victor Hugo who once said, "Hell hath no fury like a woman scorned." And Mrs. Potiphar was hell when she got scorned. And because Joseph kept himself pure, because he maintained his integrity, he is now languishing, rotting in a filthy prison. Now talk about life being unfair. Now what do you do in times like this? Now ordinarily, most people who would go through the problems like what Joseph went through, they would even doubt that there is God. Or if there's God, he doesn't really care. So what do you do when everything goes wrong? Because friends, I can assure you right now, even as a child of God, you will find yourself in difficult situations. You will find yourself in darkness. And so as we study this passage, we can find some principles that we can apply into our lives when nothing seems to go right, especially those of us who are serving the Lord. Again, remember, Joseph is not in prison for doing wrong. He did everything right. If he had been willing to commit adultery with Mrs. Potiphar, then friends, he would not be in prison. In fact, he might even get a promotion. But he dared to be different, and he purposed to be pure. And now, he's in prison. You know, in prison, I can imagine Joseph hearing a lot of voices. And one of those voices definitely would come from the enemy. And I can just imagine Satan whispering to him. Satan would say to him, "Now where is your God? You are serving him and this is the thanks you get? He doesn't really care about you. Come on, just give up." Now I don't know what the devil whispered to Joseph's ear, but I'm certain that Joseph could not understand. He was totally innocent. He was serving God faithfully. And now nothing seems to make sense. He is in prison. There are going to come times in my life and in your life when nothing seems to make sense. But principle number one, brothers and sisters, when you find yourself in a prison of despair, when you find yourself in a dungeon of difficulty, when you find yourself being a captive of depression, principle number one, don't demand to understand. Don't demand to understand. Now it's okay to desire to understand, but to demand is something different. You see, there's nothing wrong if you desire to understand what you're going through, because sometimes God wants to teach us a lesson and He wants us to understand. That's okay. But friends, you don't demand to understand because there are some things in life that you'll never be able to understand. I will never be able to understand why a 3-year-old boy would have leukemia. I'll never be able to understand. 3-year-old boy suffering from leukemia. There are things in life we cannot understand. But here's a verse of scripture. Some people have made it as their lifetime verse. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to Him and He will make your paths straight. Did you notice what it says? Lean not on your own understanding. Because friends, there will be things that you'll never be able to understand. A good companion verse to Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, and I want you to write this down. This is a very important verse. Isaiah chapter 50, verses 10 and 11. Isaiah chapter 50, 10 and 11. Isaiah here is asking a question. In verse 10, he asked, who among you fears the Lord and obeys the word of His servant? Let the one who walks in the dark, who has no light, trust in the name of the Lord and rely on His God. Now I want you to notice how God describes this man. First of all, here is a man who fears the Lord. Wow. That means he is in right relationship with God. Fear God, that's the beginning of wisdom. And then it says, not only does this man fears the Lord, he obeys the Lord. Wow. Now, if you have that kind of combination, he is a God-fearing man and he's obedient to God. Wow. And yet, what does it say? It says here, let the one who walks in the dark, who has no light, he fears the Lord, he obeys God, and yet he's walking in darkness. There is no light. Friends, we wouldn't expect it that way. We would assume that if a person is walking with God, he is fearing God, he is obeying God, that he would always be walking in the light. Friends, that's what Isaiah 50 verse 10 is telling us. It doesn't always follow that kind of sequence. Just because you're a child of God doesn't guarantee that there won't be darkness in your life. It doesn't guarantee that there won't be difficulties in your life. What it teaches us, friends, is that even though we are obedient children of God, there will come a time of perplexity, there will be a time of difficulty, there will be a time of darkness, and when you don't understand, because you have done nothing wrong, you know, you're serving God faithfully, you're giving your tithes regularly, you're living your life with integrity, you're serving the company to the best of your ability, and now you got fired from your job because there's an office mate who is so jealous and envious of your position. How do you explain such a thing? Got fired from a job when you're doing everything right. And you try to understand why God would allow such a thing. Well, friends, very carefully it says there, let the one who walks in the dark, who has no light. Now let's try to understand these words. You see, friends, darkness can never put out the light. Never. Darkness cannot put out the light. If there is no light, the only reason why there is no light is because the light has been withdrawn. Isn't that true? I mean, you can walk in a room that is full of light and then you switch the darkness on. There's no such thing. It's the other way around. When there is a room full of darkness, there's a switch to put the lights on. You see, it's not the darkness who will chase the light, it's the light that will chase the darkness. Light always overcomes darkness. And so, brothers and sisters, listen to me very carefully now. If you are walking in darkness, and you are a faithful child of God, the only reason you could be walking in darkness is because God took the light away. It's because God, for some time, allows you to go through the darkness. Oh, brothers and sisters, in some mysterious ways, in God's plan, in God's will, in God's way, in God's wisdom, for God's purpose, God has ordained that you be in darkness for some time. And when you find yourself in darkness, be very careful. Do not demand to understand. You can desire to understand, but some things are not that easy to understand. And that's why verse 11 says, Isaiah 50:11, "But now you who light fires and provide yourselves with flaming torches, go walk in the light of your fires and of the torches you have set ablaze. This is what you shall receive from my hand. You will lie down in torment." You know what's the natural response when you're in darkness? Friends, you're going to light your own fire. You're going to take matters into your own hands. You're going to make things work. Because it's not supposed to happen this way. I'm a child of God. I'm faithful in my tithes. I'm faithfully serving God. There should be no darkness. When you light your own fires, when you take matters into your own hands, very carefully it says there, "This is what you shall receive from my hand." From whose hand? From God's hand. "You will lie down in torment. You will destroy yourself spiritually when you try to demand to understand." Brothers and sisters, when God allows darkness in your life and you light your own fire and you take matters into your own hands and you try to make it work, verse 11 says that's a recipe for disaster. That's a recipe for heartache. If you demand to understand, you're going to have difficulty. So what does God say to us? In verse 10, we go back to verse 10. Here's what God says. When you go through darkness, let the one who walks in the dark, who has no light, what should we do? Trust in the name of the Lord and rely on their God. The word rely means to lean upon God. This is what David was talking about in Psalm chapter 23, when he's talking about going through the dark valley, when going through the valley of the shadow of death. He said, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me." You know that what that means, friends? Even though you don't understand, you just put your trust in God. Believe that God is at work. Believe that God is in control of your life, even when you don't understand. And so let's not get a distorted idea of the Christian life, that once you receive the Lord Jesus, everything will be sunshine and sweetness, and you'll always understand the will of God, friends. That's not true. That's not true. Because even though you're a Christian now, even though you receive the Lord Jesus Christ now, God did not promise that there would be no darkness. There may be a dark cloud, but you can be sure behind that cloud is a shining sun. We know that God is still in control. And so when you study the Bible, we find here that God's greatest saints were walking in darkness part of their lives. I mean, think of Job. I mean, he's a faithful child of God. He's described as a righteous man. One of the greatest characters of the Old Testament. In darkness, and he was perplexed. He could not understand. As a matter of fact, if you read through the book of Job, he wanted to argue with God. He demanded from God an explanation. I'm a faithful son of yours. Why are these things happening to me? He demanded from God an explanation. And you'll read in the book of Job, he was rebuked by God. Because friends, when you go through tough times, when we go through tough times, we do not demand from God an explanation. You see, God doesn't owe us an explanation. And that's what faith means. Faith is to believe that even though you don't understand, you know that God is in control. And that's where you practice your faith and trust in God. Job did not understand, but God certainly understood. You can read about Habakkuk. I mean, he's a great prophet, a man of God. But you know what was happening during his time? He could not understand why God would allow the Chaldeans to rule these barbaric hordes. Why he would allow so much violence and brutality from this group of people, and they are the ones that God will use to discipline his own children. He could not understand that. And he was demanding from God an explanation. I mean, have you ever wondered why the ungodly seem to prosper? The ungodly around us seem to prosper. Here we are, we're children of God, and we're just living from paycheck to paycheck. We receive our paycheck and we just, pay all the bills and we have nothing left. And we're children of God and we're still giving our tithes. And these people, they're filthy rich. Have you picked up the newspaper and read about the atrocities of drug-related violence, the immorality in Hollywood, the corruption in politics, the inhumanity of terrorism? And sometimes we demand from God, Lord, where are you? Lord, why are you not doing anything about these things? You know, friends, when you demand things from God, you'll be in trouble. Because you're trying to play God. And then think of John the Baptist. Do you know how the Lord Jesus described John the Baptist? He said, there was not anyone born of a woman greater than John the Baptist. Can you imagine the kind of description? There was nobody who has been born of a woman greater than John the Baptist. He was the one who baptized the Lord Jesus, and yet Herod took John the Baptist, put him in prison, and then later on beheaded him. And you know what John was doing while he was in prison? He was perplexed. He wondered, he doubted, he even asked one of his disciples, can we ask this Jesus if he's really the Messiah? You know, it already crept into him, that doubt about Jesus being the Messiah. He was perplexed, he was in prison, and he was fulfilling God's will. I mean, think of the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul, the greatest Christian who ever lived. And yet when he wrote to the Corinthians, he said, we are perplexed. You know what perplexed means? To be perplexed means to not understand. It doesn't make sense. Now, brothers and sisters, here's Job, here's Habakkuk, here's John the Baptist, here's the Apostle Paul, and the rest of us, each one of us will come to that point in our lives when things do not make sense. And when we come to those points in our lives, do not demand to understand. But listen to what the Bible says. Isaiah chapter 55, 8 to 9. I'd like for all of us to read this together. All of us, please. Ready? Read. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Now tell me now, how far is the heavens from the earth? You cannot tell me. Nobody knows. How much higher are God's thoughts than our thoughts? No one can tell. Nobody knows. Brothers and sisters, you and I do not have the capacity to understand the infinite workings of an all-knowing God. And so listen to me, just because it doesn't make sense to you now doesn't mean it doesn't make sense at all. Just because it doesn't make sense to you right now, it doesn't mean it won't make sense some other time. Joseph did not understand what was happening in his life. God is on a higher level, and his ways are higher than ours. You know, have you seen a parade? You know, they just showed us the parade in Macy's parade in I think it's in New York. And it's a long parade, so many floats and everything. And you know, when you're just standing there at that street corner and you're looking at this parade as they come across, you know, you just see one float after another. You just see the beginning and then one event at a time. But brothers and sisters, if you have a helicopter and then you ride on that helicopter, then you are on a higher level and you can see the beginning of the parade, you can see the end of the parade, and everything in between. You see, that's the thing with God. With us, we only see one point, one section of the parade, but God sees everything. He sees the beginning, up to the end, and everything in between. Joseph, all he sees was the prison, but God sees the palace. For Joseph, all he could see is that he's a prisoner in Egypt, but God can see that he will become the prime minister of Egypt. And that's why we don't question God, and that's why you don't demand from God an understanding. You just have to trust God, who sees everything. And so if God, in his will, in his sovereignty, plunges us into darkness, when you become a prison of doubt, when you become a captive of despair, when you are in a dungeon of disappointment, don't demand to understand. And that's what with Joseph. All he knew was the imprisonment and the injustice. But after some years, he'll be so amazed at what God accomplished through his life. So number one, don't demand to understand. And then number two, secondly, if you don't understand things that are happening in your life, number two, don't fail to be faithful. Second principle is don't fail to be faithful, even though you don't understand. If you look at our passage, Genesis 39, we go back to verse 20. Let's find out what Joseph did while he was in prison. Remember, he's been lied about. He's been falsely accused of attempted rape. Let's see what he's doing. It says here, but while Joseph was there in the prison, the Lord was with him. He showed him kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden. So the warden put Joseph in charge of all those held in the prison, and he was made responsible for all that was done there. The warden paid no attention to anything under Joseph's care, because the Lord was with Joseph and gave him success in whatever he did. Wow. Now what does that tell you, friends, reading those words? Brothers and sisters, what this is telling us is that even in prison, Joseph keeps serving the Lord. He didn't understand what was going on. He was sold as a slave. He was falsely accused. He didn't understand why he was in prison, but one thing he was sure of, he wants to continue serving God, even in the midst of difficulties. No matter where, no matter what, he is going to be faithful to God. You see, Joseph is not the kind of fair-weather Christian. Do you know a fair-weather Christian? A Christian who will come to church when the weather is fair. You know, everything is going okay. These are the kind of Christians who sit and raise their hands and praise the Lord. I have money in the bank. I have a clean bill of health. Praise the Lord. You know, these are the kinds of Christians, fair-weather Christians, when their children get sick, they stop giving their tithes. There are some Christians, when they get a bad report from the doctor, they stop praising God. There are some Christians, if somebody hurts their feelings, they stop attending church. There are some Christians, if they get offended, they step down from their responsibility. Those are the fair-weather Christians. And friends, Joseph was not a fair-weather Christian. Even in the midst of difficulties, even if things were not working in his own ways, he kept serving the Lord. even when he didn't understand. You know, I love this word. Somebody said, you can tell the size of a Christian by what it takes to stop him. You can tell the size of a Christian by what it takes to stop him. You know, the Apostle Paul said in his letter to Timothy, preach the word in season and out of season. If you're one of those Christians who serves God when the sun is shining, when everything is going your way, then you're not much of a Christian. You have to wonder if you're even a Christian at all. What do you do when nothing happens, when something happens to you and it doesn't make sense? What do you do when everything is in darkness? Well, friends, I'll tell you what to do. Keep giving your tithes. I'll tell you what to do, keep praying. I'll tell you what to do, keep witnessing. I'll tell you what to do, keep praising God. I'll tell you what to do, keep attending church. I'll tell you what to do, be faithful unto death, unto the Lord. And God was with Joseph. And those words are repeated several times throughout the biography that we have here. And God was with Joseph. Even though he didn't understand, he remained faithful. We see his integrity at work, we see his industry at work, and God blessed him all the more. You know, he did not grumble, he was not sulking, he was not beginning to pout or become angry with God. You know, he was faithfully serving the Lord. And so friends, if I ask you that question again, are you a fair weather Christian? You know, I've been pastoring for 10 years in the Philippines, and I've seen some church members. They're the most faithful church members. They sing in the choir, they witness, they tithe, they are faithful, you know, they're happy and they're joyful. And then, let a loved one dies, then they lose a job, and then sickness come, and then cancer come. Something happens that doesn't make sense whatsoever. You know what they do? They drop out. They quit serving. They fold up. Oh, brothers and sisters, even when it doesn't make sense, continue to serve the Lord. Keep singing. Keep praying. Keep giving. Keep witnessing. Keep giving your tithes. And Joseph did, and the Bible says very clearly that God was with him. The same God who was with him in good times is the same God who was with him in bad times. So friends, when it doesn't make sense, don't demand to understand, don't fail to be faithful. And then number three we see here, don't bow to bitterness. Don't bow to bitterness. That's the third thing we learn here about Joseph. He refused to get bitter. You know, there are a lot of bitter people in many churches today. And people are bitter primarily because, you know, somebody did wrong to them. They're bitter because they were mistreated. They're bitter because somebody gossiped about them. You know, they're bitter because their efforts were not acknowledged. You know, they did something, they gave something, they served somewhere, and their names were not called and recognized. And so they're bitter. But brothers and sisters, let me assure you that nothing can be worse, nothing can be more damaging to the soul than bitterness. And that's why this is a great lesson from Joseph. In Genesis chapter 40, Joseph was still in prison, but there was a butler there and there was a baker there, and they had a dream, and Joseph interpreted to them the dreams. And the butler it was a positive dream. And then here's what Joseph told the butler after giving him the interpretation of the dream. He said, when all goes well with you, remember me and show me kindness. Mention me to Pharaoh and get me out of this prison. I was forcibly carried off from the land of the Hebrews. And even here, I have done nothing to deserve being put in a dungeon. Now try to look at those words. Do you sense there the spirit of bitterness? I mean, if you actually look at those words, friends, he didn't even mention about his brothers. Did you notice that? He didn't even mention about his brothers. I mean, for a natural man, people today, Joseph would have said something negative about his brothers. He would have said, those rotten, good-for-nothing brothers of mine, they sold me to slavery. He did not say those bad words. I mean, he was very factual. He said he was sold into slavery. That's just a fact. But friends, you don't sense bitterness there. He didn't even mention Potiphar and Potiphar's wife. I mean, if he's a bitter person, he would have said something negative about Potiphar's wife. He would have said, that ugly scum of a woman, Mrs. Potiphar. He had such a bad B.O., you know. And you don't say some things, you know, negative about this person. You sense immediately there's something negative. There's bitterness in his heart. But friends, you don't find that here. You know what is so sad? It's that there are Christians today who are eaten up with bitterness, but not Joseph. In fact, Joseph is described in the New Testament. Here's the Apostle Peter writing about this, and it's an appropriate, accurate description about Joseph. Peter said, but how is it that your credit, how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and injury? But if you suffer for doing good and injury, this is commendable before God. Wow. You know, that's a great verse that describes the life of Joseph. Brothers and sisters, we need to be careful about times when we are in darkness, not to be beaten. And not only will you drop out of the ministry and stop serving, but if you get very bitter, wow. Friends, Hebrews 12:15 says, see to it that no one falls short of the grace of God and that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many. You see, it will not only affect you, it will affect many. You know, bitter people are not very nice people to be with. Bitter people are critical people. They have a lot of bad things to say about others. When you hear a brother or sister say negative things about somebody else, two things. Is a bitter person or is just a very negative person? This person is just too negative. Or this person is bitter. Bitter people, they keep a list of bad things that have been done to them. Now that is already proof positive, brothers and sisters, that what you did for somebody is done for God. Because when this somebody mistreats you, then you tell this person about all the good things you have done for this person. That is already proof positive that you're a bitter person. But friends, the most dangerous effect of bitterness, listen to this. Bitter people find it hard to forgive others. Bitter people find it hard to forgive others. When you find it hard to forgive somebody, well friends, that's the root of bitterness Hebrews 12:15 is talking about. That root is already there. Unless you forgive, you'll never be released. That root is never taken out from your heart. You see, forgiveness is not doing something good to the other person, it's doing good something for yourself. It releases you from all the negativity. It releases you from the poison of bitterness. If you withhold forgiveness from people, then that poison remains in your heart. And when you're poisoned in your heart, it will come out in your lips. You will hear those negative descriptions. Somebody said, bitterness is the acid that destroys its container. And many people are eaten alive today because of bitterness. Some old grudges. And you can be sure of this, friends, bitter people focus on the faults of others and they see nothing of their own failures. Did I go ahead with that? Then, bitter people focus on the faults of others and see nothing of their own failures. But then number four, when we go through those dark times, when you don't understand, friends, don't hurry providence, don't try to rush God, let God be God. And so number four, don't try to push providence. Don't try to rush God. Let God be God. When you don't understand, don't push providence. Remember Joseph's request to the butler, his request to the cupbearer, he said, but when all goes well with you, remember me and show me kindness. Mention me to Pharaoh and get me out of this prison. And that's Genesis 40 verse 14. Several verses later, verse 23, here's what it says. The chief cupbearer, however, did not remember Joseph. He forgot him. Now that, a man of ingratitude, isn't it? You help him and he forgets about you. So here is Joseph languishing in prison. The cupbearer forgets about him. You know, it seems like Joseph is now the forgotten man. His father, believe, is already dead. His brothers have forgotten him. Potiphar has forgotten him. Potiphar's wife has forgotten him. Pharaoh has forgotten him. The baker is now dead. The butler has forgotten him. But brothers and sisters, let me assure you, there's one who hasn't forgotten Joseph, and that is God. You see, God will never forget. God is always there. He is always in control. When you are in darkness, do not demand understanding. Remain faithful with your service to the Lord. Don't bow to bitterness. And friends, don't push providence. You see, allow God to be God. God is never late. Genesis 41, verse 46. Here's what happened. It says that Joseph was 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Wow! He was now 30 years old. That means, friends, if you do some calculation, he was sold into slavery at the age of 17, and then he went to Egypt. And let's say he was about 20, 21 years old when he was accused of attempted rape. And then he's in prison for about 9 or 10 years. And now he comes out of prison, he's already 30 years old. Brothers and sisters, you see, God has his own schedule. You don't trust God. You just wait on God. Don't be impatient with God. Allow God to be God. You see, our problem with God is that we're impatient with him. Lord, I want to be rich now. Lord, I want to have a baby now. Lord, I want to do this now. Lord, I want to have a girlfriend now. Don't be so in a hurry. Just allow God to be God. You don't need a girlfriend now, Josiah. No, I'm sorry. I'm just talking to Josiah. The young people, I mean. You just have to wait on God. You know? It will come, it will come. You know, well-built and handsome. Huh? That kind of combination. It's a deadly combination. But friends, listen to how God describes himself when he is the one working it. Psalm 37, verses 5 and 9. Commit your way to the Lord, trust him, and he will do this. He will do what? He will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn. Your vindication like the noonday sun. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways and when they carry out their wicked schemes. Refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret. It leads only to evil. For those who are evil will be destroyed. But those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land. Did you see that? What God's timing is? It says there, friends, if you missed that verse right there, I'm sorry. Not that one. This one. It says there, he will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday sun. Friends, that's how God operates, like the noonday sun. You know one thing about the sun? You cannot hurry it up. You cannot stop it. The sun is always on time. You don't adjust the sun. The sun is in the wrong place right now. It should be well ready, but the sun is still here. No, friends, you adjust your watch, not the sun. The sun is the reference for the watch. If the sun is not yet there, 90 degrees, it's not yet 12 noon. If it's 12 noon already in your watch, adjust your watch, not the sun. That's the way God operates. God operates in a way no one can control. He will do things in his own time. You just have to trust him. You just have to believe in him. Another good scripture. Don't try to push providence. Another good scripture is 1 Peter 5, 6. Humble yourselves. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in what? In due time. Sa mga Cebuano, in due time. Due time na lang. It will come. Due time na lang. In due time. You see, God is never ahead of time. God is never 1 second late. You can never hurry up God. He can turn your Calvary into Easter. He can turn your midnight to sunrise. And those who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. Trust in the Lord. Don't hurry providence. And that's number four. Don't try to push providence. And then finally, number five. Friends, when you are in darkness, don't let your dreams dissolve. When you are in situations you cannot explain, don't let your dreams dissolve. Joseph had a dream, and what was the dream? He dreamed that one day, all the world's resources and the world's rulers will just bow down to him. That was his dream. His brothers thought that this was a foolish dream. He got even a warning from his dad. But you know, Joseph never gave up on the dream, even though the time was bleak, even though there was no light at the end of the tunnel. If you look at Genesis 41, it says there, Genesis 41 verse 40, you shall be in charge of my palace, this is Pharaoh speaking, and all my people are to what? Submit to your orders. Only with respect to the throne will I be greater than you. So Pharaoh said to Joseph, I hereby put you in charge of the whole land of Egypt. Wow. 30 years old, 10 years in prison. 10 years in prison. And now he is exalted. The forgotten prisoner is now the famed prime minister. His iron chains were replaced by gold chains. Here comes Joseph, and all Egypt is now bowing before him. This is the one who did not demand to understand. This is the one who did not fail to be faithful. This is the one who did not bow to bitterness. This is the one who was willing to wait. This is the one who did not allow his dream to dissolve. I don't know what dream God has given to you, friends. But remember this word, somebody said, don't doubt in the dark what God has showed you in the light. Don't doubt in the dark what God has showed you in the light. When you go through those dark times, don't doubt. Don't dissolve your dreams. Allow God to work out His plan. And friends, just because it doesn't make sense to you now, does not mean it will not make sense one day. Serve Jesus, never quit. Give Him your heart and give Him your life. And don't you ever, ever lose your dream. What is that dream? It's never too late to have a dream. But friends, bring it before the Lord. And so finally, we ask our question, our title was a question. What to do when life doesn't seem to make sense? Well, friends, we learned at least five principles. When life doesn't seem to make sense, number one, don't demand to understand. Number two, don't fail to be faithful. Number three, don't bow to bitterness. Number four, don't try to push providence. And number five, don't let your dreams dissolve. You know, there is one verse, I would summarize the life of Joseph. Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. This would be a good summary of Joseph's life. Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. Let me call the worship team now to join me here. Friends, let me close with a true story. And this is the true story of the life of Alexander Solzhenitsyn. Alexander Solzhenitsyn was a brilliant Russian literary genius, but he's also a dissident. And he was a dissident when communism was so powerful in Russia. And Alexander Solzhenitsyn was placed in a prison camp, the Gulag. And he told, when he was finally released, that he was put in this labor camp. They took from him all his books, all his writing materials. They had no radio, no television. There was no input from the outside world. The prisoners themselves were not even allowed to communicate with one another. All day long, laborious, back-breaking, standing there, armed and ready to shoot anyone who tried to escape. Solzhenitsyn said this went on day after day after day, and then he said, I wondered if anybody even knew I was here, much less did they care. He said, finally, I decided that I would end my life. But my faith would not allow me to do that. He's a Christian, you know. I knew it would be wrong for me to take my own life, but my mind then became twisted and perverted. He said, I had the idea that perhaps if I would try to escape, then they would shoot me, and I would not have taken my own life. They would have killed me. I know that was wrong, but my mind was twisted. I found the day that I was going to do it. I was sitting under a tree. They had given us a few moments from the work. I was sitting in the shade of a tree. I saw the Russian guard with his gun. I had seen before, and perhaps I will never see again. Perhaps it was an angel. I don't know. But he came and stood in front of me. Remember, we were not allowed to communicate, not even to talk. But he looked into my eyes with a look of compassion and understanding, though not able to say a word. And he had a stick in his hand, a twig. And in front of me, on the ground, he drew a cross and walked away. I knew that that was a message from God. And what I was about to do was wrong. And I settled back down. I asked God to forgive me because of the message he sent to my heart. Little did I know that after all, that all over the world, people were pleading my cause. And in 3 days, I would be set free. I would be a free man in Geneva, Switzerland, 3 days from the time I saw the cross. Brothers and sisters, that's a true story. Alexander Solzhenitsyn is a Christian. And I believe that man may not even be an angel, maybe the Lord Jesus Christ himself. But if he took his life that day, his dream would have ended. He held on. He kept his faith. And 3 days later, he was released from prison. I don't know what you're going through these days. Maybe you have some doubts. Maybe you have some fears. Maybe there are things in your life that is not right, and you're demanding an explanation. Well, friends, God is here. We need to just trust God. And God is always in control. Let's not rush God. Let's wait on Him and trust Him to move. Let's all stand as we sing. And after some time, if you have any concern, if there's anything in your heart and in your mind that you'd like to be prayed for, I'm going to ask the L5 to join me here. We will be praying for you. We don't have to know your problem. If you want to share, that's good. If you don't just want to be prayed over, we will be praying for you. Let's sing this. And a second time, second round, we're going to welcome people to join us to be prayed for. L5, join me after we sing this.
This solid ground, firm to the
here to pray with you and pray for you. Just join me here now, El Fight. And let's just pray for people. Just continue singing as people are coming in. Let's be praying for them. You may share your concern, or you may just want the El Fight to just pray for you straight away. That's okay. So El Fight, just pray. Just choose anybody you'd like to pray for.
Body away, the light of the world by Thank you.